Thank you for joining us today for the virtual Sunday service with the Center for Creative Living. CCL, a charter of the Universal Church of the Master, has served and supported the spiritual needs of its community here in the Bay Area for over 20 years.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Was that better? We're turned on now? I like it when we're turned on. Whoops. Well, how's it going so far, Mary? Up here in your spiritual leadership position. Okay. I just want to welcome you all here. We're very excited to have one of our own speaking about her very powerful trip. And this is a good time to bring our energies together. So I just ask you to begin to open your heart and to allow the energy from the highest source to come through you and just begin to circulate in this room so that we're all impacted by that higher energy. And at the end of the service, we will release that higher energy. We have more than a few places where it can go and do some good, eh? So without much further ado, Miss Janet, I will have you do an opening song. Thank you.
So I just invite you to just settle into the healing circle of this group and know that this is an amazing time for us to be together and to drink in the energy. I drink in the energy of all that I have lived. I drink into the energy of all that I have lived. So what's amazing is it sounds exactly like we're in harmony. No, it's not you, honey. It was a sound over there. No. It did, didn't it? We were in harmony. There we go. I'm loving it. So wherever music comes, we embrace it and we take it into our bodies, minds, souls, and hearts. I breathe and my heart beats. I am here, I am here in this moment. Oh, I take a breath of life. Every dream I hold, let me dance, dance, dance on the edge of this moment. Let me sing, 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 and all my love flows out like a river and like the sun and moon. Our light is here and we breathe. We breathe.
everybody kind of come back and settle in, because I'm going to introduce our speaker. And our speaker is a member of the Center for Infinite Growth Board, and would the people who are part of the Center for Infinite Growth Board just stand up for a little minute all together? You too, come on, up, 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 up. Don't think you can hide from Grandma. Yes. Thank you, and thank you. Bea has an incredible story to share with us that was a real happening, and I think it will move everyone as much as it has moved us. So I look forward to her sharing it with you, Bea.
All right. I am so excited to finally be sharing this journey about Machu Picchu. Joan has been waiting for this for about a year now, she encouraged me to do it. And I know that a few of you, I know Joan and Carolyn, have been to Machu Picchu. Has anyone else here been to Machu Picchu? No. Okay. Well, maybe if there's time in the end, if there's any, you know, anything that you'd like to share, that experience you had. Because I feel these spiritual centers like Machu Picchu, everyone gets what they need, right? You know, everyone's experience is going to be different, and you'll get exactly what you need there. This was my first trip to South America when I went in November of 2022, and I spent the first week living with a really amazing Peruvian family. I was volunteering part-time in an after-school program in Cusco through a group that also offered Spanish classes. And this provided me a great way to get immersed in the culture. You know, living with a family, I was with young children that were, you know, from Cusco. And it also gave me the opportunity to get acclimated to the high altitude, because Cusco is actually at 11,000 feet. It's even higher. Machu Picchu is at 8,000. But parts of my trek were going to go to up to almost 14,000 feet. So my primary goal to go on this trip, of course, is I enjoyed the volunteer work, but then I really had wanted for a very long time to take that 26-mile trek on the Inca Trail. It's a 4-day, 3-night trek, and again, altitudes of almost 14,000 feet at a place called Dead Woman's Pass. But unbeknownst to me, though, at the time that I booked the trip, it would more from a like now or never physical list, you know, physical bucket list challenge and spiritual renewal, to also provide a unique opportunity to grieve and heal from the impending loss of Peter, my ex-husband, and the father of my children. So why Machu Picchu? Before delving into my own personal experience, I think it's important to tell you a little bit about Machu Picchu, because it intrigues, you know, travelers, adventure lovers, nature lovers, historians, and spiritual seekers from all corners of the globe. So what's the big deal? So briefly, kind of historically and culturally, Machu Picchu has been a UNESCO World Heritage Site since 1983, and it was also voted one of the new 7 wonders of the world in 2007 when a worldwide internet poll was done. Machu Picchu means old peak in Quechua, which is the language of the Incans. And it was believed to have been built in about 1420 and was likely abandoned only about 100 years later when the Spanish, with the Spanish conquest of the Inca Empire. Thankfully, for grateful visitors like me, due to its remote location, it's, you know, safely nestled in the Andean Mountains, the city remained undiscovered and untouched by the Spanish conquerors who invaded Peru in 1532. And it wasn't rediscovered until 1911, that's almost 400 years later, when Hiram Bingham, a history lecturer at Yale, was searching for the lost city of the Incas called Vilcabamba, and he met a local farmer who knew all about Machu Picchu. The locals up in the mountains knew, and he took him up there thinking maybe that's what he was looking for. It wasn't, but that's how Machu Picchu was uncovered. And it's almost like that sacred space, the jungle had almost engulfed it. It was almost like it was protecting it for a very long time before it could be seen again. It is one of the most famous archaeological sites in the world, and a testament to the advanced engineering and masonry skills of the ancient society. For example, the granite stones that they used to build the walls in the primary buildings were cut with such precision that you can't even stick a knife blade in between the stones. And the Incans, the reason why that's so incredible is that they had no iron tools or mortar at that time. They had no pack animals or wheels to move those heavy granite stones up the hill at that time. And then the terracing around Machu Picchu was used for farming, but most of all, it actually kept the city from sliding down the mountain. It's built on an earthquake fault, and it's still, all these years later, still there. Of course, the natural beauty, I have some photos later, I'll put the slideshow on again if people want to see it. It's stunning when you're in that environment. And there's something about being in the mountains, you know, I'm a very big nature lover. That's kind of my place, my spiritual place. So I'm hiking and out in nature a lot. It's like a mystical, you know, there's a lot of cloud forest, and it was so cool when I was driving in today, some of the clouds were hovering or the fog was kind of hovering, and I thought, oh, this just reminded me of Machu Picchu. And I went at the end of November, early December, so everything was lush greenery. It was starting to rain. It's the beginning of the rainy season, and it was amazing. A third thing, of course, adventure. People like me love to go and do that hike. That Inca Trail is a personal challenge. It's probably one of the, maybe if not the most famous hike kind of in the world that people know about all over the world. And the reason why it's so special for me is that, you know, the belief was it was the original pilgrimage route to Machu Picchu leading to the Sun Gate, which used to be the actual entrance to Machu Picchu. So the emperor Pachacuti had built it about 14,000 miles of roads around Peru and other parts of South America. But most of those roads are really more down, you know, on the flatlands by the Urubamba River. So the feeling, a lot of people feel that, you know, going up and down in the mountains, it's a very different feel than just a utilitarian road to get from one place to another. And then, of course, well, you know, for many of us here, why I went, that spiritual and mystical appeal of it, you know, that ethereal atmosphere in the remote location, it really does give it a mystical aura. And many visitors are drawn to that because of the energy, spiritual significance, and the opportunity to connect with ancient wisdom. There's about 150 buildings at Machu Picchu, and there's many temples. There's the iconic Temple of the Sun that was believed to be used for religious ceremonies, astronomical studies, and a solar observatory. The Incas had believed in kind of a complex religion that was associated with astronomy and also identified seasonal changes for their agriculture. Because the Inca had no written language, we don't know exactly why it was built, but the most likely explanation is that Emperor Pachacuti built it as a royal estate and sacred retreat space for the elite people of the local empire. Of course, you can find a lot more details about Machu Picchu in books and on the internet, but I just wanted to touch on the main reasons why people are so enthralled about it and why you hear about it so often. It's just a unique and awe-inspiring experience for anyone visiting. Especially for me, I will say, to be honest, in the end, walking the Inca Trail was way more significant than actually going to Machu Picchu, because it's time-stamped. You're only allowed to be in there like 2 hours. I had less time there than I did, of course, walking up and down. There's Inca ruins throughout the Inca Trail. So the actual journey there was more significant for me personally. So shifting to my personal experience, I wanted to just touch on four concepts that guided me to Machu Picchu at that particular time, and then kind of to survive the Inca Trail to Machu Picchu, and finally to open up to that unexpected blessing along the way. So the basic concepts for anyone on a spiritual path that can consider and explore is that, at first, it reinforced my unwavering belief that in divine timing and divine order. Secondly, it confirmed that I should always follow my intuition, despite what, you know, others might think or say, or if steps to my final destination don't go completely as planned. A third one was just having an increased awareness of how we can tap into our deep soul connection and to strengthen us, remember us, and that we're never alone. You know, I live alone, and sometimes I forget that if I'm feeling like I need help, I forget sometimes. God's there for me always. And then the last one, the fourth one was, it provided that opportunity for me to grieve and release while trekking through the Andean Mountains on that Inca Trail. When we're open and willing, the power of infinite creator, divine feminine, mother, father, God, is there for us. And our higher power is always available to bless us and heal us when we access it. So the first one, you know, believing in, you know, with all my heart in a divine timing. I have literally been feeling like Machu Picchu has been calling me for 35 years. I was first introduced to it when I read, I think, Shirley MacLaine's book. That kind of piqued my interest, Out on a Limb. You know, she talks about her mystical experiences in Peru en route to Machu Picchu. So I was only 28 when I read that book. And then, you know, a few years later, I got married, I had children, I was immersed in family life, I was running a business. You know, the thought of visiting Machu Picchu was placed out on the back burner for me for a long time. Then in 1987, we moved to a new home in San Jose, and one of my neighbors, lo and behold, where did she grow up and was raised? In Cusco. And so she would always talk about Cusco and Machu Picchu, and she said, oh, we'll have to go sometime together. Of course, you know, that didn't happen, but it was always in my mind because she had a deep love and connection to her homeland. And then I also had a coworker come to me at one point, say, oh, I just went to Machu Picchu and did a hike. And then, of course, I'm part of a hiking group that's been hiking together for 10 years, and several of the people had been to Machu Picchu. And one of the young men, who's not really a spiritual guy, he went twice on the Inca Trail because he was so moved by the experience. So I think, again, if you go into a place like that, no matter what your belief system is, you're going to find something there that's going to touch your heart. So after 35 years of having books, neighbors, coworkers, and hiking friends entice me to take a trip to Machu Picchu, we fast forward to August of 2022. I had returned to work at Cisco after a brief 10-month retirement, and I was pondering on how I could combine my volunteer hours. Cisco gives you 80 hours a year to volunteer anywhere that you want, and they'll pay you for it as long as you're giving back to the community. So I thought, how can I combine that with a vacation? Yeah, isn't it great? And people take advantage of it. You know, we do so much community service. The one thing I love about Cisco and the culture. So I had hoped to travel during that 10-month stint in my retirement, my voluntary retirement, but COVID hit, and all the things I thought I would do when I took that early retirement, I mean, I couldn't really travel internationally. So COVID changed my plans, and I know that at a soul level, I was really feeling a deep sense of wanderlust. And in a reading with Reverend Dottie, I lamented to her how about, you know, what limited travel I had during COVID, and then she just planted this seed. She said, you know, you can travel towards the end of the year, you know, and if you do, I see nothing but goodness around that trip. And so it got me thinking, because normally I don't travel at the end of the year. I knew at Christmas, Matthew, my son, and his fiancée Sahej were visiting from Boston. And I thought, well, what about Thanksgiving week? You know, we have a couple holidays there. Where can I go at Thanksgiving where the weather is tolerable? Well, it's the Southern Hemisphere, you know, where it's springtime. So all that kind of came together, and that was my divine timing, that this was the time I could go after 35 years of, like, when can I go? This was it. So that's kind of the divine timing, believing in that. Then the second one is just following your intuition, even when sometimes I can be a doubting Thomas in many ways. And I checked my options with this international volunteer headquarters, and luckily they had one-week volunteer stints, both in Lima and Cusco. And because it was kind of off-season and a U.S. holiday, there were volunteer openings, so that kind of worked out. It checked out. I mean, this is like August I was checking. But then I can kind of, you know, I kept going back and forth. Should I do this? You know, the guidance about going at reserving your time in the Inca Trail is like 6 to 8 months. You know, this is August. I was looking at November. And the Inca Trail, they, you know, for good reasons, it's that UNESCO World Heritage Site where it's legally protected. They only allow 500 people a day entering the Inca Trail. Now that sounds like a lot, but it really means that all the porters, the guides, it's more than the tourists. We had more porters and guides than we had on our tour. So it means that that's really maybe 200 people that they allow to come in per day. So anyway, and then I kept thinking about, can I really climb that, you know, 14,000 feet? I had never hiked at that altitude. I've been maybe at half the altitude, and I was really dealing, you know, and I hadn't camped in a long time, and it was going to be the rainy season. I thought, can I sleep on the ground? Because when you're doing that physical challenge and you're not well rested, you know, that's not a good combination. But anyway, so all these thoughts were mulling through my mind. And now it's like the last day of September. I told you, I just kept going back and forth. Should I do this? And I was on my computer, and you know how Google knows what you're doing. Google knew that I was investigating Peru. And so what happens, an ad popped up for a touring company offering treks to Machu Picchu and the Inca Trail. And it had a big headline saying, book today, it's going to surely sell out. And I thought, God, it's the end of September, you know, August. I mean, Thanksgiving is, what, 2 months away. And I didn't have my airline tickets. I hadn't really reserved that volunteer slot yet, so I hadn't talked to them in maybe a month. I hadn't checked with my boss to make sure I could take the 2 weeks. I just did it. Because I know that when we really tap into our intuition and into our heart, that's our higher power talking to us. That's God talking to us. And we need to pay attention. You know, we're all sparks of God, and that inner knowing is ours whenever we choose to access it. So once I made that decision, all the pieces and details that I cobbled together fell into place just like that. And that's how it works when you're in alignment with the universe. So that's the second concept, follow your intuition. The third one is tapping into a deep soul remembrance and asking for divine guidance, for help to sustain me and strengthen me when I need it, because I needed it during times of that trip. So from the moment I signed up on that tour, for the tour, you know, my neighbor said, why didn't you come to me? I have friends and relatives in Cusco that I can vouch for. She said, did you get a personal recommendation? And I said, no, I just followed my intuition. And I had a young coworker grew up in Argentina, and he was telling me that he did the Inca Trail in his 20s, and he was a strong and fit football and soccer player. And, you know, he found it very challenging. So, you know, you have all this stuff kind of going in the back of your head, because he was like thinking, yeah, B, or, you know, not that he said it, but he was thinking that, you know, that you're pretty old, B, to be doing that. But anyway, and then I found out later that the several people who had encouraged me to go later clarified. The one said, well, I never really did the Inca Trail. I only did like a 2-day hike or something, one night over. And then the other person's, the other person that I knew had gone to Machu Picchu, I said, well, did you do the Inca Trail? And she said, oh, no, I took the train in. And so again, all of that, kind of that doubting things. But to help me counter that fear and doubt, I want to just point to Joan. So I had gotten a short reading from Joan at the 2022 UCM conference, and we had talked about finding partners late in life, and she had she shared an experience of hers, and I didn't think much of it. But then 2 weeks later, she contacted me and she said, I have more information for you. I really have guidance I need to share with you. And so we finally connected. And she said that she had gotten the sense that I had had several lifetimes where I was a protector of women, and that men were maybe not that important to me in those lives. And she said, that might be coming into this lifetime. So it was interesting that she said that. And then I did some research and archaeological digs, found graves of priestesses and even a warrior queen from ancient Peru dating well before the Incan civilization, some 1,700 years earlier. So yeah, maybe I had been there in South America. And Joan, at the time when she called me and we did the reading, she had no idea I was going to Machu Picchu. And I said, did you know I'm going to Machu Picchu? And she said, no. I was kind of sharing with her how I was, you know, feeling a little nervous about, can I do this? Can I really physically do this? And you know what she said to me? She said, you'll be able to do it because you've been there before. You've done this before. And that, you know, when you hear that truth kind of resonating in your heart, I thought, oh, I have. I've been there before. I can do this. Because I'll tell you, step by step, walking on that trail, you know, there's one very tough day, and you're getting up at 4:30 in the morning. It's about 10 miles of hiking, and you're going actually up two mountains, so you're going up to 14,000 feet, going down again, and then going up again and camping. So it was a very challenging day, but that kind of kept me going. As I was walking, I thought, I've done this before. I can do it. And I had really no trouble. I mean, I had taken altitude medication prior, just in case, and I was fine. So I was very happy I could do it. But I wanted to just share, when you're walking that trail, you know, you really get a sense of the indigenous people there and the Mother Nature, and appreciating the Inca mythology. They worshipped into the sun god and Pachamama. I put a little card, my goddess cards, Pachamama meaning Mother Earth, and Apu, the spirits of the mountains. And for me, it's all one universal power, infinite power, but it was refreshing to immerse myself into an ancient culture and world, and just the sheer beauty of being in that space, away from cars and pollution and distractions and you know, kind of urban density that we live in here in San Jose. So interestingly, the family that I was staying with in Cusco had never heard of the touring company I signed up either with through that random ad. They said, I've never heard of that one. And they were, and I thought, okay, I'm fingers crossed. And I remember when I took a taxi there, the taxi cab driver couldn't find the address because the street was similar to another street, and he was just getting frustrated and lost, and I finally found it. But I will tell you, you know, again, just following your intuition, our group was quite a bit smaller than most of the other ones that we met along the way. The Inca Trail, again, is very monitored, so we would run into the same maybe two or three touring groups along the way. We had 8 out of the 11 hikers were women. All the other groups that we passed, there were a lot of young, kind of macho. It was more men, you know, few, you know, there were couples, of course, but there were definitely more men. And our little group, we came from the U.S., Russia, India, Australia, and the U.K. And the whole energy of that group was very soft and supportive. And I remember one of the people, and one of the sisters was so sweet, the little girl from Montana. Her sister was 18, and she had a very bad cold. And her sister was maybe 22 and was just so motherly and caring for her sister. It was just heartwarming. But several of the people said, you know, this is a special group that we're here. So even if I would have been in another tour group, it would have been quite a different experience, I think. And although most of those people were in their 20s and 30s, and there was only one hiker my age who happened to have made it to the base camp of Mount Everest, so he was much more skilled than I was, I was never far behind those Montana sisters that were like mountain goats that had been climbing mountains really since they were toddlers. I had spent that week in Cusco to also acclimate to the altitude, and that was my biggest fear, that the altitude sickness would be something that would be a problem, because I hadn't dealt with that before. I do want to give credit to my son Matthew, though, because from the time I signed up, he said, Mom, don't worry, you can do it, because you know there's going to be people that are less fit than you, or are in worse shape than you, I think is how he put it. And that was a compliment from him. My son is a marathon runner. He can do 26 miles in 5 or 2 hours or whatever, two and a half hours. So for him, it wouldn't have been as challenging probably. But now I want to get into that fourth concept. And I will try not to get too teary, but I keep coming back to this healing that happened and the synchronicity and the divine timing of being at Machu Picchu at that time. And that was just having that opportunity to grieve and being kind of in a place where I just had the opportunity to do it. But to put it into context, several months prior to my trip, before I was even booking it or even thinking of Machu Picchu, I had a dream about Peter, my ex-husband, which was unusual because he we had been divorced a long time, and he lived in Florida. And for the last 3 years, I couldn't really communicate with him anymore. He was in a memory unit, and he couldn't speak anymore. So when he was living at home in Florida with his father, we used to talk all the time. But gradually, you know, his ability to communicate just went away, essentially. And then just weeks before my trip, so I asked the kids, I asked Christina, I said, has the guardian, Peter's guardian, mentioned anything about him not being well or something going on? And she said, no, he hasn't mentioned anything. But then 2 weeks before my trip, the guardian did contact my kids and said that Peter had been declining both mentally and physically and cognitively for the last few months. And that would have been right around the time probably I had that dream. And he was wheelchair bound and he needed assistance. And the guardian said there's not an immediate emergency, but they were starting to consult hospice services. And I consciously remember thinking, I hope he doesn't cross over while I'm in Peru. Yeah. So this after that second day on the Inca Trail, that one, that really grueling day, you know, we were very exhausted and in our tents right after dinner, like 8:30 or 9 p.m., and it was raining that night. And you know, water, the whole water is emotion and bringing emotion out and the cleansing and clearing. And I remember just, you know, I was exhausted, but I remember hearing kind of the raindrops kind of dancing on the tent, and I thought, I just fell asleep instantly. And once again, I dreamed about Peter. And he was kind of, you know, the old Peter that we hadn't seen in a very long time. The kind of the happy, loving Peter from the past. When I woke up the next morning, I was very troubled by that dream because there's no cell service on the Inca Trail, and I would not have internet access for 2 days. So I wasn't sure if he had crossed over. I didn't know. So as we were starting to descend down the mountain, we were going through a cloud forest, and like between the mist and the air, and you could hear the sound of water trickling along the mountains. It just opened up the floodgates. I was crying through most of that stretch. And luckily, you know, we were kind of descending down a mountain. It was a little bit, you know, sometimes you're wide trails, but sometimes it's pretty narrow. And so we were all in single file. And it was just like, you know, everyone was kind of in their own thoughts. And it was quieter than usual because usually everyone, you know, it's a hiking group and we're having fun. But it was just like this divine timing and moment that I, you know, that I wouldn't have had when I'm working. I find that, you know, I'm just so, my life is so busy all the time. I don't take enough time to process things. And it was just a gift. I just tears streaming the whole time. And that was the only day, that third day was the only day that we actually had free time. So we descended down the mountain after that grueling day. We had free time in the afternoon, and there's this beautiful town called Winnewaina. It's only about 3 miles outside of Machu Picchu. So we had the whole afternoon to be there. And I was, you know, at Machu Picchu, it's very restricted. You can't touch the stones. I mean, it's protected. But we were able to, that afternoon after lunch, we all went our own way. You know, some people were laughing and joking. I spent the whole afternoon by myself and just touching the energy. You could feel the energy just in the stones and the power of that. And then really having time to just kind of bask in the beauty of the mountains. You know, most of the time you're just trying to get through each day, right? But this afternoon just allowed me to just be there and to feel the peace and just feel so connected to everything, connected to the earth, to Mother Earth, to Gaia, Papa Pachamama, and it was amazing. And then we discovered our guide told us that yes, in fact, that location 3 miles outside of Machu Picchu had been like a final clearing and cleansing. There's all kinds of fountains and water thing that the nobility that came through there, they did. That was a place of clearing and getting ready to go to the Machu Picchu. So it was just amazing. When I was putting my hands on that stone, I connected with Peter, and I said, you know, because again, I didn't even know if he was alive, but I just said, could you please hang on until I return to the U.S., you know, until like let me get out of Peru so I could be there, you know, with Christina. I said, please hang on. And so I returned on Friday night, December 2nd, and Peter's guardian contacted us that he was nearing the end on Monday. So Matthew was able to fly from Boston to Florida and to be down there to take his grandpa to see Peter one more time, and then enabled him to put the phone up to Peter's ear so I could just say goodbye and tell him I loved him. And Peter made his transition the next day. So it just turned out, again, divine timing. I took the next day off, and Christina and I got together and supported each other. So I honestly think the stars aligned for me to fulfill that 35-year dream of visiting Machu Picchu at that very time. It opened up the door for many months of grieving and healing of a marriage of 21 years. And you can tell I'm still emotional when I think about that time. It's still emotional to me now. So not only did I return, another divine timing piece, the last one I'll mention, is that the day after Peter passed, that was a Tuesday, the next day the Peruvian legislator voted to remove the president, Pedro Castillo, from office, and they arrested him on charges of conspiracy and rebellion, and there were widespread protests from supporters that impacted the transportation to and from Machu Picchu. So that was literally within less of a week that I got back home, there were many tourists stranded there, and some of them were walking back along the train tracks to get back to the Sacred Valley. And, you know, my right knee had really been bothering me. I could not have done that. I mean, I would have been stuck there till whenever the trains were operating again, because I could not have done that extra mileage. So kind of in conclusion for all of you, believe and trust in divine timing. It is there. And follow your intuition, because that's God talking to us. Tap into your higher power whenever you need that support, and pay attention to feelings or insights that may be from another lifetime or the environment that you're in. And finally, be open to unexpected opportunities for healing whenever they arise. So thank you.
That was wonderful, Dee. Really, we have to thank you for being so willing to open your heart, because that's one of the things that we try to do for each other in this church. As we say, this is a heart church, not a head church. Certainly, we think about things. There's nobody here who doesn't use their head. That's, you know, that's part of how life works. You use your head, but it requires attention and desire and trust to use your heart at the level that B used your heart to get to Machu Picchu. Now, maybe it's my own pitiful personal condition that allows me to think there's other ways to do that besides going to Machu Picchu. We have to know that we do use our body. You know, you didn't get here if you didn't use your body. But that we have to trust that and bless that and say to ourselves, as B must have said to herself with her hands on the stones many a time, I don't quite understand this, God, but I'm trusting that there's a plan. I don't quite know what you're up to, God, but I trust it's for my highest good. And the more we acknowledge to the divine force knows what we're thinking. It isn't like God says, oh, hooray, I've always wondered what Mary thought. No. If the divine force wants to know what we're thinking, it just checks. But it's up to us to be willing to say, I want to share this. I don't have to hide it. I'm not afraid. And so I just ask that each of you in this time, this little time we have together, and we will use it. I'm going to have Joan come up next both share the basket and to talk to us after that about that. And then Janet and I will play a song. Huh?
And
Chris?
Can we Can I speak on behalf of
Chris
Zoomers?
No, Chris is going to close after that. Chris has her very own spot. But we are going to, after,
I was going to catch up. The Zoomers have had some comments, if that's okay.
The Zoomers would like to make comments on their comments.
Oh, sure. Okay. Go ahead.
Okay. Now I'm on the spot. Let's see.
So everybody knows what's going on, right? The thing is transmitted electronically, thanks to our dear friend Ed. And then they hear it at real time. So now there's some that would like to comment on it.
They sure do. Let's see. From Donna Christensen, good morning all. I hop, probably meant I hope you are all well. Hop would work. Milana Maria, good morning from Milana Maria. Donna, again, Christian, we cannot see who stood up. Who was on the board of CIG? Who was it that stood up? Their name?
CIG board. Who's on the board?
Oh, yes. Carolyn. Sure, McGinnis. This is Carolyn McGinnis.
Okay.
Sandy Payne and Kathy Curler.
Okay.
And me, and B.
Me and B. Oh, there
me
you
me.
Go.
And Tom is sorry that he's not here. He was just not feeling up to par today. So.
And from Chen Lee, yes, hike the Inca Trail. From Donna Christensen, I am headed to Machu Picchu in May!
Oh, wow.
And let's see. From Chen, oh, yes, Death Woman Path Pass. Ann Corbin, Machu Picchu is on my bucket list. This is a side one from Donna. Are us boomers be able to see the slideshow? I mean Zoomers. Both apply, though. Let's see. So what we may do with that is, B, if you have a recording of your slideshow.
Can you show me how to do that? I'm not sure.
Yeah, you'll probably end up sending it to Eileen.
Okay.
And then what she might be able to do is append that to the end of this video that gets uploaded to YouTube. And maybe she can put some background music behind it, if, although you have some. So anyhow, I diverge. And from Chen, watching sunrise at the Sun Gate was just so magical and ethereal. You did that?
Yes.
Okay.
And that was the original entrance into Machu Picchu that the Incans used. It's, of course, not anymore. There's a big entrance. You know, it's different now.
And then from Lynn Rogers is, will I be doing readings as discussed with Mary? If so, at what time, if desired?
How many readings she is able to do is depending upon what time it is, and we're closing on our time now, so we'll see. We hope so.
Right. Okay. And then, let's see. From Ann Corbin, your story reminds me of the Celestine prophecy, also synchronistic. And then from Sky, wow, thank you, B. What a wonderful experience. I could feel the incredible bond you had with Peter. So sorry for your loss. I also feel the awesome spiritual awakening you had in Peru. And this is Ed ad-libbing. When you said that, my feeling was you needed to be in those energies so you and he could connect and you could see him in his prime.
Yeah.
Well done. Let's see. Ah, from Donna. She's has a lot to share today. I am wondering if you got your jacket in Peru.
I did. That's why I'm wearing it. This is Peruvian. Thank you for mentioning that.
Actually, let me turn on your mic.
I think it's alpaca.
It is alpaca.
Is it soft?
Yes, it's very warm, too.
And from Lisa Kay, thank you, B. Your story resonated deeply with me. I've had similar experiences while being in places like Machu Picchu. I empathize deeply with you. From Janice, great talk and adventure, B. Thank you for sharing. From Ann Corbin, thank you for sharing your amazing adventure, B. Beautifully told. P&J, Patty and Joyce, fantastic talk. Thank you so much for sharing. And from Neil Forrest, my heart is with you all. Thank you, B, and everyone else.
Neil's on our board also.
Okay, Neil is wonderful. That's what Janet said.
Everyone's wonderful, but
there we go. And from Lynn, I'm reminded by the talk of Peter Coral and his contributions to us all. And now we are caught up. I return control of this meeting back to you, Mary.
Thank you for sharing. Can I get those comments after the service? This? Okay.
Okay. Yes. Oh, I could give you the baskets. I'm sorry, that was thoughtless.
That's okay. We will manage. I have a couple of things to say before we do the collection. Number one, I did go to Machu Picchu. I did not hike the trail. I rode the train and the bus. It was still wonderful. I remember there's a myth about this huge stone that leads into an underground community. And I laid on the stone and just let myself go. And all of a sudden it came to me, if I don't get off this stone, I'm going to be in the underground community forever. But it is a totally, it was a wonderful experience for me. I weighed 60 pounds more than I do now, and I had not been walking like I do now, and I still was able to get around, and the elevation is truly very challenging. So, and one of the things I saw for B was, as I was talking to her, I was spreading out my cards and deciding to pick up a card. And the card I picked up was Sun Goddess. And I said, oh, you're going to be fine. You're a Sun Goddess. Yeah. Okay. Who else went to Machu Picchu? Did you have anything you wanted to add?
It was just one of the most incredible experiences of my life.
You have to speak a little louder.
Come here.
Just quickly.
This is
Carolyn.
Here's Carolyn.
So I went, I was 72 when I went, and I thought, oh my gosh. I didn't think about it. I thought, yeah, I'll do this. I could do it. And it was very challenging. We were in Cusco for 3 days before we started hiking, and I don't breathe like, but I was breathing like that, you know. And but some of the hikes were very challenging. I went with 10 women, and I was the oldest. And at one hike, we were going up this steep hill, and I was the last one, breathing heavy, and all of a sudden they all broke out in the Rocky song, dun da da dun da dun da, and clapping and all that. And it was just, you know, I felt so supported and so loved, and it was a time in my life where I really felt like I saw myself. Yeah. And it was so powerful.
You were a Sun Goddess too.
Oh, thank you.
There's more than one Sun Goddess.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. The group I was with was not as harmonious, but I so I won't talk about that part. But we had a wonderful time. I want to tell you about cookies.
Okay. Yay, cookies!
The other day I was out with my daughter, and I had ordered a Safeway grocery delivery. And I said, oh, I'm so worried. I'm hoping Jeremy will be there to get it because I ordered ice cream and it will melt. And she said, well, should we go home? I said, no, we just have to do this. But what if I get melted ice cream? I'm so worried about this melted ice cream. Now, do you think your thoughts create your world?
Yes.
Oh. So when I got home, there were 4 bags of groceries. There was no ice cream. But there were cookies. So I called Safeway and I said, you know, I didn't get my ice cream, but I got cookies. And I said, well, keep the cookies, do whatever you want with them, and we'll send you ice cream tomorrow. So what I want to tell you is that there's a divine order. I got my ice cream. It was not melted, but I got it a day later, but it was secure, and I got free cookies for you guys. And there's little cookies inside of each one. So if you choose to take one of these, you may also want to share it.
We need some ice cream.
I have this deck, you know, how many of you have decks of cards that you use for just fiddling with? Yeah. Okay, this is my deck. It says, "You are magic," and one of the cards in there says that a positive attitude brings, good things to you. Thank you so much. Mm-hmm. And anyway, afterwards, I'll spread these out, and you can get your magic message. Okay. Haven't we had an extraordinary day today?
Yes, wonderful.
Yes. And I want to thank Bea for her wonderful talk. We texted back and forth, and she was saying, "I don't know, I don't know." I said, "You're going to be fine, you're going to be fine."
Yay.
Was she fine?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Do you have your program?
The program has a question in it.
Okay. I want to remind you that if you give monthly through the mail or however you do, in addition to that, please put something in the basket so that everybody gets the idea of giving here. Because we do love our spiritual community, which is the first line of my prayer.
And since it's a CIG service, they get the donations.
Okay, great. But we love our spiritual community and we support it financially. So will you say this with me?
Yes.
Okay, here we go. I give the spiritual community. And so it is.
Yay.
Okay, blessings, and enjoy the cookies. I forgot. I almost forgot about that. Gosh, I promoted myself last week. I thought last Tuesday was my talk. Guess what? It's this Tuesday. Okay, but I'm flexible, right?
Yes, you are.
I'm flexible about ice cream and cookies and talk dates. So, on Tuesday at UCM, on Zoom, so tune into Zoom for my talk on astrology. And I have 6 questions that I've made up about astrology that are commonly asked. So this is going to be, I'm telling you, I'm a student of astrology, not a certified astrologer. I'm a student of astrology. These are questions that are often asked. And I'm just going to have a very basic talk on how a little bit of knowledge about astrology can help you. And of course, astrology was my first introduction into the whole spiritual world when my kids were little and I was a stay-at-home mom and endlessly read books on astrology and loved it so much. So that's on Tuesday on Zoom.
No, I'm going to because we have a firm stop time. Bad things happen, we're told, if we run over our time. And I very much want you to hear what
Chris
Brown, my very good friend. So, right, sometime I can't think of Tom's name, you know. We've been married for 50-some years. It's hard to get old. You take what you need to tell us what you're going to tell us, because it's very exciting.
Yes.
Good.
So I need to know how much am I going to condense what I have?
Thank you.
How much time? How much time would you like me to take?
About 4 minutes.
Okay.
But it's okay. I don't see anybody here who's going to tell. No, you won't tell, will you, if we run over a minute?
Oh,
okay.
Yeah.
Assalamu alaikum. Peace be upon you. Do you know the response? Alaikum salam. Let's just try that. I'm going to say it again. Assalamu alaikum. You guys say, Wa alaikum salam.
Wa alaikum salam.
Peace be upon you, and peace be upon you too. And now the final extent of my Arabic. La Allah, Hayl Allah, Muhammad Rasul Allah. I'm going to say that again. La Allah, Hayl Allah, Muhammad Rasul Allah. And that means there is no God but God, and Muhammad is his prophet. We're going to talk about Ramadan. Ramadan. And Amina reminds us it's not a D, it's a Ramadan. So Ramadan is the name of the month that in which it was first sent down to Muhammad, the Holy Quran. That's a nice picture, isn't it? Mm-hmm. My work sent that picture out. That's stunning. As a clear sign and guidance in judging between right and wrong. So Ramadan is a time when we get to remember the difference between right and wrong and make our good choices. I'm going to give you a little bit of history because I'm a history buff. I'm a head and heart. The fast, so during Ramadan, Muslims fast. That's kind of the key thing. Ramadan, fast. Those really go together. Ed, can you turn it down? The fast was begun to commemorate the revelation of the Holy Quran. So what happened is that Ramadan was already a month. It's the ninth month, but it moves around because it's a lunar calendar. And for thousands of years on the Arabian Peninsula, there had been nomadic tribes and herdsmen and sheep, horses, and camels. That was a long time. And out of that grew a city called Mecca. Well, over time, Mecca became more and more important, more and more involved, and it began to degrade, morally degrade. And Muhammad was a noble, he was an orphan, but a noble, and he was born into that. And he felt really bad about it. And he would go to the caves nearby and meditate. And one day, in the year 609, in the cave, he experienced a revelation that profoundly changed him. While he was meditating, Muhammad was visited by the angel Gabriel, who revealed the first words of what would later be known as the Quran. The angel told Muhammad that these words came directly from Allah, and Allah is the one and only God. La Allah, Hayl Allah, Muhammad Rasul Allah. At this time in Arabia, it was common for people to worship several different gods, but the angel said, well, there's only one, so deal with it. And then you're the prophet, you're the guy who gets to go out and tell everybody. And over the next 23 years, the remainder of the Quran, the holy book of Islam, was eventually revealed to Muhammad. And by the way, he could neither read nor write. So this was all in recitation. So the Ramadan, the fasting of Ramadan, is to commemorate the revealing of the Quran. So when is Ramadan? Well, it starts on a different date every year. And this year it starts either Monday or Tuesday, kind of depending on who sees the new moon when. If you're living in the southern countries like Chile or New Zealand, you'll fast for about 12 hours, the daylight time. But if you're living in the northern countries, in Iceland or Greenland, you'll have to fast for about 17 hours. Pregnant women, nursing, and prepubescent children are exempt, and we would never want to do anything that would hurt our body because the body is for God. There are five pillars of Islam. One of them is the one I've said about oneness, and then there's prayer, and there's charity, and then pilgrimage to Mecca, the Hajj. And that fourth one is Ramadan. So by fasting, one is fulfilling the fourth pillar of Islam. So what does it actually look like to practice fasting? You get up before sunrise, eat a light meal, and then many people work. So if you are working, or you know people who are working, your Muslim colleagues may be fasting. And I actually asked a friend of mine on Friday. I go, are you fasting? She goes, no. I go, okay. Treat them gently, because this is a month they're going to be doing this where they don't eat, from O-dark, right? O-dark 30 to dusk. And then the end of Ramadan is a feast called Eid al-Fitr, the feast of breaking the fast. It's a big party, big family reunion, and lots of good things happen, kind of a, I hate to say it, sort of a Christmassy kind of a thing. Gifts and clothing and things like that. And this happens all over the world. During Eid, Muslims gather in their homes, mosques, parks, community centers, offering special prayers and celebrations. It is a joyous occasion marked by a strong sense of purpose. And there is a greeting. Have a blessed Ramadan, Ramadan Karim, or Ramadan Mubarak. Let's just try those two. Ramadan Karim.
Ramadan Karim.
Ramadan Mubarak.
Ramadan Mubarak.
Have a blessed Ramadan.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. And we're going to do a closing music, but we probably shouldn't do music, but if you come up here and we do just a couple of lines of Our Lord, Hear My Prayer, I think we can do them together. You want your guitar? I don't care.
No, we can come up.
Okay. So we're going to say, Oh Lord, Hear My Prayer, and have you re-energize the energy that you have been putting out. And then at the end, we are going to release that energy to the divine forces that come to us only through the light. They can be any, you know, they can be Islam, it can be Christianity, it can be Judaism, it can be, any number of groups. But as long as they come through the light, they may use the energy that we created here today to further the good outcome in their universe. Okay?
Oh Lord, hear my prayer.
Into the light for the calmness and peace upon ward space, for the love that goes one to the other even through difficult times. We ask that this energy be a tool for those in spirit and those doing the work to add to the peacefulness of this our universe. And so it is, and so it shall be. Amen. Thank you all for coming. What a wonderful day. Thank you, B, for sharing it from your heart. Thank you, Joan. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Chris, whose name I do know, and for telling us a little bit about Ramadan. And, you know, and if you're really desperate for more information about Ramadan, you can watch the FBI on Tuesday, because that really tall guy, I don't know if any of you ever watch it, he's a Muslim. And he does, at times like this, he will, like, go to the church and do the prayers, puts his little rug mat down. And so that's, it probably is more information from television on Islam for other people than we often see. So one of the things they were writing about in on a newspaper is that in years past, we learned a lot of things about, like Star Trek and those things, that there was more truth in some of those, absolutely, than we realized. And so we have to trust that if things are not allowed to be put out, like in school, we can hardly control what goes on in school, some pretty creative people put some things out for us to learn from that we might not otherwise find. So thank you all for coming. Bless you all for another week, and we'll see you next week.
Yes.
Okay. Yay.